This is probably a good time to begin. We have a quorum. My name is Leo Ratikovsky. I'm a professor here in the physics department. And as a host of this event, it gives me a great pleasure to welcome you all here this evening and to have this wonderful event that we have every year in Boulder as part of so-called Boulder Summer School. But before we begin and introduce tonight's speaker, I wanted to say a few words to introduce to you what this event is, if you haven't been part of it before. So this series of public lectures is really part of what's called Boulder Summer School for Condensed Matter and Material Physics that is held here annually on the CU campus, and in particular in the physics department. So this year is a bit special. As you can tell, we're doing everything virtually due to COVID, but we hope to be back in person, subsequent years, next July. So keep an eye out for us. And we always try to advertise these public lectures quite broadly. But to give you some background on the school and this event that is sponsoring this public lecture, let me mention that every July, we invite about 65 best and brightest physics PhD and postdoctoral students in physics from all over the world to attend 4 weeks of lectures delivered by world experts in the annual topic of the school. And every year topics vary. And in fact, this is the 21st annual school with past schools covering subjects as diverse as biophysics to superconductivity, magnetism, quantum information, glasses, and disordered systems. So the range of expertise and the range of topics is extremely broad, but it focuses on the subjects of material physics and condensed matter physics, things that you can hold in your hand as opposed to universe and galaxies and stars. So the school is very generously supported by the National Science Foundation and the University of Colorado, and this public event is therefore an example of your tax dollars at work. And so I wanted to extend a gratitude to all the support for those of you who support science so kindly through your tax dollars and allow us the scientists the privilege to do physics and to bring a little bit of taste of science and physics and why we love it so much back to you through such events. In terms of the protocol on Zoom, most of you after a year and a half of this pandemic, you probably are familiar with it, but let me just set some rules of the game. We welcome all clarifying questions during the talk. The way I would prefer you pose those clarifying questions, like quick clarifying questions, is through the chat tool in your Zoom window, at the bottom of your Zoom window typically. However, if you have more detailed questions or maybe open-ended philosophical questions and beyond, please save those for the end of the lecture, the question and answer period that we will have in about an hour after the lecture starts. So with this, I will turn over my duties to my wonderful co-organizer, Professor Kaden Hazard. He's a professor at Rice University and is one of the co-organizers. The other co-organizer is actually online as well, Anna Maria Ray. She's a local and a big celebrity, local celebrity theorist, both a professor in University of Colorado in the physics department and is a fellow at JILA. And the other co-organizer, I'm not sure if he's here, is Ian Spillman. He may not be with us, but he's also been instrumental in allowing us to put the wonderful program together, this four-week program together, and in particular this public lecture. So without further ado, I'm gonna hand it over to Kaden to introduce our speaker tonight. Go ahead, Kaden.
So thanks, Leo, for the great introduction and welcome everybody. It's really my pleasure to get to introduce Wolfgang tonight, and you may I don't know if those of you on YouTube can see him, but on Zoom, you can see he's walking through some hallways. He had some Wi-Fi trouble, so I will talk until he can find a good place to get some Wi-Fi. Wolfgang has been extremely impactful for our field. He's really from the start of our field of ultra-cold matter in creating these quantum gases and new phases of matter. He was one of the pioneers of it and has continued to be just as impactful for the last 25 years. So he will be great at helping us appreciate what ultra cold matter is and why we should be excited about it. As a little bit of biographical background, Wolfgang got his diploma, basically equivalent of a Master of Science degree from the Technical University of Munich in 1982, got his PhD from the University of Munich in 1986, and then he moved on to a postdoc at the Max Planck Institute in Garching, Germany. Then he moved on to another postdoc at Heidelberg, where he was working on very applied sort of projects. He had a project with Volkswagen studying combustion reactions spectroscopically, for example. But he must have missed the intellectual freedom of pure research. And so he moved on to a postdoc position at Massachusetts Institute of Technology after that in 1990. Where they realized what they had and offered him a faculty position in 93. And he's been at MIT ever since. So he still does a lot with spectra and looking at things spectroscopically, but very different than combustion reactions these days. He has many accomplishments. So he created the first what's known as a Bose-Einstein condensate, a new form of matter in 1995. He has developed many fundamental tools which are in use today. I believe he holds the world record for the coldest systems in nature of 500 picokelvin, which are more than a billion times colder than outer space. And he has way too many awards for me to list. The I.I. Rabih Prize, the Fritz London Prize, the Benjamin Franklin Medal, a smaller known one, the Nobel Prize he won in physics in 2001, I believe. So it's my great honor to have him sharing his vision for our field and his research with us tonight. Wolfgang, whenever you're ready.
Welcome, Wolfgang. Your microphone is muted.
Okay. You need a minute or?
Great. Now.
Okay, no. Sorry, I needed your help to get unmuted.
Okay. Now,
good evening, everybody. As you see, I'm outside a building at MIT, and I'm just standing in front of a building because half an hour ago, we had a major internet outage in Belmont, where I live, and I made the call. I drive to MIT, where I have internet access. Yes, I have internet access at MIT, but I have to get into the building, and we have to fill out a COVID attestation to get access to the building and to the office. I did that, but there is a 20-30 minute delay until I can open my office. So I hope in 10 or 20 minutes I can go to my office and sit down, but for now I'm standing outside the building with the beautiful night sky and one of the nicest, you know, inner beats at MIT. So let me start the talk, and I think in 10 minutes I would just say, let me just try to get into the building where I have a wired internet access, dual monitors, and everything I need. But right now I'm literally standing up in the street, and I hope everything works. So let me share the screen. I'm disabled for screen sharing, so if the host could activate my screen sharing.
Yes. Veronica, can you make Wolfgang a co-host, please?
Okay, that seems to be done. And I share now my screen. I go to PowerPoint, and it should now start. So I hope everything is connected. You can see me, you can hear me, and you see my presentation. Okay, so this is a public lecture, and unfortunately, I don't see you, because my first question would be, who of you is a non-physicist? And well, I would imagine, based on experience, maybe a third or so. And I have to tell you, the lecture is for you. The lecture is not for the participants of the summer school who know already everything. I was asked, at least that's how I understood the charge of the organizers, to talk to the general public and convey why is our field exciting. So the talk I'm giving is basically the foundations of the field. Why is there so much excitement to do research with ultra-cold matter and ultra-cold atoms? So I want to talk about what is the coldest matter in the universe. And these are quantum gases, gases which behave very strangely according to the rules of quantum mechanics. And let me point out that those quantum gases form at extremely low temperatures. And just to set the scale, I want to remind you that, well, we are encountering atoms and molecules in nature all the time, and our skin is constantly bombarded by molecules in the air. And I think, you know, people should know, what is the speed of those molecules? How fast are the zillions of molecules which hit your skin every split second? Well, the answer is they are as fast as a jet airplane. So they are not at the speed of light. They are not at a slow speed of a car. They are at the speed of a jet airplane. And that's something you should never forget, because there is a connection through the speed of sound. You can only hear me, well, in a lecture hall, I would say, because my words travel to you through the speed of sound. Well, right now, my sound only travels from my mouse to my microphone. But nevertheless, there is only propagation in air because the molecules move. And the speed of sound is pretty much the velocity of the molecules, the thermal velocity of the molecules. And you also know that a jet airplane moves close to the speed of sound. So therefore, I hope you never forget for the rest of your life, the molecules which hit your skin, they bombard your skin with the speed of a jet airplane. Well, I want to talk about now cooling gases down to nanokelvin, and then the speed of sound will be a mere centimeter per second. And actually, if I would talk to you in a lecture hall at this low temperature, everything has slowed down so much that it would take more than an hour for my voice to travel to your ears. So that's pretty nice, but maybe as an introduction to a public lecture, I should say, why would you like to have cold atoms? The example I've given you so far, with cooling gases and cooling atoms, you could slow down communication, and that's definitely not the purpose of cooling atoms. Well, historically, when our field developed, the motivation to get to lower temperatures and cold atoms was actually driven by precision measurement by metrology. As you can imagine, we have learned a lot by observing atoms and molecules in nature. But until a few decades ago, we could only observe the atoms and molecules while they were moving, literally at the speed of a jet airplane. And people thought, if we can slow down the atoms and the molecules, we can have a closer look. And that eventually was the motivation to develop cooling techniques for cold and ultra-cold atoms. And let me illustrate that with one application of atomic spectroscopy, namely the atomic clock. For the global positioning system, for worldwide communication, for navigation, we rely on the timekeeping by atomic clocks. And in a conventional atomic beam clock, shown on the left-hand side, you have a long beam tube, and cesium atoms move at the speed of a jet airplane, at the speed of sound. So you have about a few thousandths of a second to observe them while they fly through the apparatus, and then they hit the walls of the apparatus. Now, with cooling techniques, cooling atoms down to very, very low temperature, people can now build, and in Boulder, Colorado, you have several examples in the National Institute of Standards, you can build atomic fountain clocks where the atoms travel at 10 centimeters per second. This is 1,000 times slower than the conventional beam apparatus, and therefore the precision of timekeeping was increased by a factor of 1,000. So there are other applications in navigation and interferometry where lowering the temperature of atoms means higher precision for metrology and sensing. But to make slow atoms, it just means everything is in slow motion. However, in what makes our field so interesting, that when we cool atoms down from the speed of a jet airplane to centimeter or millimeter per second, something else happens. It's not just a slowdown. It's not the same system in slow motion. There is a phase transition from classical behavior to quantum behavior. And in the case of bosonic atoms, there is a phase transition that the atoms literally start marching in lockstep. And you know, phase transition is really something dramatic. You go, the system completely changes its property. And if you don't believe that how dramatic a phase transition is, try to jump into a frozen swimming pool. You will immediately notice the difference. And so this is what happens at low temperature. The atoms shown here as little guys will undergo a phase transition and start marching in lockstep. Not because there are forces which synchronize them, it is simply the quantum behavior. So what happens is this marching in lockstep is a wave phenomenon where all the atoms belong to, you can say, one wave function, one orbital, and they just form one big wave. So if I want to explain this striking difference between ordinary atoms, which move randomly, and those special form of a quantum gas where everything marches in lockstep, I can use the analogy with laser light. You all know the difference between light from a light bulb and a laser beam. And it's obvious there is a big difference. And if you want to describe the difference, you would say the laser light is coherent, it is a single mode, or all the photons march in lockstep. So you would pretty much use exactly the same words as you use to distinguish these atoms marching in lockstep, the Bose-Einstein condensate, from ordinary atoms. So if you want to explain the phenomenon for which eventually I received the Nobel Prize, it is I was able to create for atoms what the laser is for light, or we managed to realize atoms with the properties of laser light. Okay, let me ask, is the connection good? Can you clearly hear me? I mean, I could just continue, or I could try to get into the building now. Well, it's actually pretty cool with the background and the lights on, or, and I feel comfortable. So maybe I just stay outside. Nobody bothers me, it's not very windy. So let me just go back to my little pillar, put the computer on this concrete pillar and continue talking. Okay.
And Wolfgang, it's also, there's nothing more special than to have a Nobel laureate give a lecture in the middle of the Cambridge, Massachusetts, in front of MIT. So, you know, it's really is a one special lecture.
In the background with the black blue tiles, this is building 26. And this is yes. The building where my laboratories are. And this is where all the So anyway, I don't want to really spend a lot of time telling you how do we make atoms cold, what are our cooling methods, how does our refrigerator work. I would rather like to take you to the lab and give you sort of a feel how, what is it, what does it mean to do experiments in with such cold atoms. So what it shows you here is, well, our first generation ultra-cold atom machine. And it has a vacuum chamber here, but it is completely surrounded by optics, cables, magnets, water cooling, all the gadget it takes to do such experiments. But the most important thing are the students. The students who design the machine, who build the machine and operate the machine. So this is still something which, if you if you have two graduates, two or three graduate students, they can actually start in an NT lab, build such a machine in two or three years, and then make discoveries with the new machine. So here is a close-up on another vacuum chamber. You see a vacuum viewport. The diameter is around 4 inches, and it is right behind the window where we can create nanokelvin atoms. We cannot touch them, but we can look at them from all angles with laser beams and cameras. And everything we do involves laser beams. And I should say, if I walk into a lab, I still get a tick out of it, seeing the magic of those laser beams. And that's actually something pretty special here, because we have three different colors of laser light. We have yellow light. This is the resonant frequency for sodium atoms. We have red light, which is the resonance for lithium. So we are working here on an ultra-cold mixture of sodium and lithium atoms. And the green light is for special purposes. And here you see another close-up through a vacuum chamber. And what you see here is in the middle, you see literally a fuzzy yellow ball. It emits yellow light. And these are sodium atoms, which have been cooled down to about millikelvin with laser cooling. This is 1,000 times colder than interstellar space, but we still have to go another factor of 1,000 in temperature to eventually observe a quantum gas and Bose-Einstein condensation. So anyway, this is the scenic tour. That's how it looks in the lab. And now I give you sort of the cartoon description. So imagine in one of those big vacuum chambers, in the middle of it, we have a million atoms, very, very cold, nanokelvin temperatures. And those atoms are held in place by electric or magnetic fields. We cannot put a material box around it because we have only learned how to cool the atoms themselves. We cannot cool a material container. So we confine the atoms with magnetic or electric fields. So the idea is an atom, if it has an unpaired electron, is magnetic. And it has a spin, it has a magnetic moment, like a compass needle. And when the atom wants to move away from the center, there is an inhomogeneous magnetic field which pushes it back. So this is what I mean is we have a box, we have a container, or we call it atom trap, made of electric or magnetic fields. So you would say, but what can you learn about it? You cannot touch the atoms. How do you put in a thermometer? How do you figure out what the properties are? And let me just give you one example how we can take measurements. We can just switch off the box because it's just an electric or magnetic field, and then nothing holds the atoms together. That would mean they would just expand due to their thermal motion. And then we can flash on a laser beam shown in blue here. And this laser beam is scattered, and then we cast a shadow on a digital camera. And what you see here is the shadow of ultra-cold atoms, the shadow of the laser beam in the cold atoms. So now, if you look at this shadow, you can immediately figure out how cold the cloud is, because it was allowed to expand for a certain time between switching off the box and taking the picture. And all we have to do is we have to divide the radius of this cloud by the time of flight. Then we know the velocity, then we know the kinetic energy, and we know the temperature absolutely. So this is how we measure nanokelvin temperatures by directly implementing the new definition of temperature. Temperature is defined in terms of energy, and for gas, it is kinetic energy. Okay, so this is how a very cold cloud looks. And these atoms have been cooled, they expand, they eventually hit the wall of our vacuum chamber, and our pumps take care of them. But now, a moment later, we can make another cloud, and let's assume we turn the dial on our refrigerator a little bit colder. So the next cloud, which I want to show you, is a little bit colder. And that means the shadow is a little bit smaller, because a colder cloud has a smaller velocity and expands less in a given time. So now I want to show you a series of pictures where we successively lowered the temperature of the cloud. And you see, as expected, that the cloud shrinks. But you also observe, maybe right now, it's not just shrinking, something happens. There is something like the pit of a cherry inside. We call it a bimodal distribution. And what you also observe is what is inside there, it's not round, it is elliptical. So let me play it again. We start out with a sphere, with a perfect spherically cloud, round cloud. We lower the temperature, the cloud is shrinking, and now there is a phase transition, and the phase transition is indicated by something forming inside, like the pit of a cherry, and what forms inside is distinctly different from with what we started. We started with a circular cloud, and now we have something which is elliptic. So let me explain what you have seen. What we haven't really changed the temperature a lot, but you have seen that this object now, this elliptical object, is much, much smaller than the initial cloud. And that means there is no random motion, there is no thermal velocity. This cloud, which you see on the screen now, it does not expand. It is really, really cold. And these are the blue guys which march in lockstep. And what you have also seen is the change in symmetry, and that's something very important for physicists. If the symmetry changes, that means there is a sudden change in behavior. So what you have seen here is, I actually didn't tell you, that our magnetic containers are not round, they are elongated. Well, if you try to construct a magnetic container, you figure out it is much, much easier to make an elongated container. However, for atoms which are in random motion, which move as randomly as my hair in the wind, those atoms are just spreading out in all directions isotropically. And therefore, the shadow is perfectly round. But when these atoms marching in lockstep, when the Bose-Einstein condensate forms, then this is only one wave, and the wave is then getting elongated in an elongated container, and this is what you see here in the elliptic shape. So these quantum gases, and I just showed you one of our first observations of this, are extremely cold, and I also gave you at least a flavor how we make them. But let me now show you more directly that those atoms are not just very, very cold. They have also this special property that they march in lockstep, and that means they are a single wave. So how do you show that something is a wave and not particles? Well, you do an interference experiment. And if you have something which is not a wave, like red paint, and you create two red spots of paint, what you simply find is paint and paint gives darker paint. But if you replace the paint by laser beams and you have two laser beams, you find something manifestly different. You have now an interference pattern of darkness and brightness, and there are regions in space where you find light and light gives darkness, because the positive and the negative electric field of the two laser beams can add up to zero, and that means darkness. Or the same happens if I would go down, you know, 100 yards to the Charles River, and I would throw two stones into the Charles River, I would create two circular waves. And right here where the two waves intersect, you form a standing wave. And in a standing wave, you have places where the motion of one wave and the motion of the other wave lead to a standstill, lead to a node in the standing wave, because motion and motion can add up to a standstill if positive and negative velocities of the two waves add up to zero. So I think now you get the idea. Two laser beams, two stones, two waves, we need two Bose-Einstein condensates. And this is now a spatial picture obtained by light scattering. It's not a shadow picture. It's on a much smaller scale. As a reminder, 100 micrometer is the thickness of the human hair. So that's what you're now looking at it. And what you are seeing is that we have now taken the green light as a knife and we have taken the green light to cut the Bose-Einstein condensate into two pieces. It's a little bit like Star Wars, where, you know, the laser saber is like a knife. Here, a green laser beam is a knife to cut the Bose-Einstein condensate into two pieces. So now we have two Bose-Einstein condensate. We let them go, and then they penetrate into each other. We illuminate them with laser light, and we take a shadow picture. And now the question is, does the shadow, does the picture of the atoms look like red paint, or does it look like laser light? And this is what we observed. So you observe, you see here kind of the shadow, but the shadow is clearly structured in dark and bright fringes. It's a little bit noisy. We cannot use a lot of light. You have to be very careful when you, you know, use light and want to observe cold atoms. But what you clearly see here is an interference pattern, and you see it's perfectly regular. So this is a single wave. But you also observe there are regions, you know, between the black lights where light comes through. But if the light comes through, there is no shadow. If there is no shadow, there are no atoms. So what you observe now is the equation then that atoms and atoms can add up to vacuum, to nothing, because the positive and negative wave function can add up to zero. But that's exactly what laser light does. So when you go to Stockholm and receive the Nobel Prize, it's of course a fantastic celebration of science, and you experience all sorts of things. You have, you know, dinner with the king and queen, and you stay for a week in the nicest hotel in town. But what is also very, very special, your Nobel diploma is a piece of art. An artist has drawn here my research. What you see is the Bose-Einstein condensate cut into two pieces with a laser beam. And the atoms are particles, little bullets, but also waves. And here they form the interference pattern, which I showed you on the previous slide. Okay, so that's already a clear manifestation for the wave properties. Now, this wave-like properties also imply something, an important property of the gas, namely that it is superfluid. Superfluid means it can move without any friction. And this is related to superconductivity, where electrons move without friction. And I mean, this is one of the reasons also why we are studying the Bose-Einstein condensate, because we want to learn more about frictionless transport with the ultimate goal of finding recipes for better superconductors in the future. So the question is, how do we show that the gas is superfluid? The most direct way to show it is show that the gas, when it moves, moves in a wave-like form. And the best way to show it is by doing rotational motion, because, you know, some of the physicists know, of course, rotational motion is angular momentum is quantized. So it is often rotation which brings out the quantum character of an object more dramatically than linear motion. So what we want to compare now is what happens when we rotate a liquid. It can be a normal liquid. You can do that at home with water in a bucket. Or if we use a quantum gas, which is what we've done in our laboratory. And what is important here is that a quantum gas has to obey the rules of quantum mechanics, which are the rules of waves. And the one thing I have to remind you is when it comes to waves, to de Broglie waves, to quantum waves, the wavelength is inversely proportional to the velocity. So in other words, if something moves faster quantum mechanically, it wiggles faster. It is a wave of shorter wavelengths. And if you cool it down, the wave gets longer and longer. So let me now use that to tell you that a quantum gas cannot, must not, is not allowed to rotate like the water in your bucket. Because the water in your bucket under is a rigid rotator, and for a rigid body, the velocity, the radial velocity increases, the tangential velocity increases linear with the radius. But now, remember, when a wave goes into a circle, the wave has to close on itself. This is the rule for waves. We have an integer number of wavelengths per circle. But that means that the velocity, if it were purely tangential flow, cannot be continuous. At some point, it jumps from one wavelength to two wavelengths to three wavelengths per circumference. So we have necessarily discontinuities in the velocity. So if you take that literally, you would expect that if you have a quantum gas in your bucket, that it would have regions which move, and then suddenly the velocity jumps, as I've shown here, in sort of concentric rings. But nature is smarter. Nature has actually figured out that the rules for waves can be obeyed by not creating these large scale rings, but creating vortices where each of the dots has the velocity structure of a mini tornado. So in other words, the best way, the lowest energy way for quantum gas to rotate is to spontaneously form these vortices. And well, it's getting summer, it's going hurricane season. So people in the, not in Boston, but further south, people will actually see a tornado from a large distance. But you can also observe a smaller version of that at home. So now we take one of those quantum gases and we set it in rotation. And that's again where our green laser light comes into play. It's like a spoon now, where we are stirring the cup. We are setting the quantum gas in rotation. And then when the quantum gas expands and we have a look at it, we see that it looks like Swiss cheese. It has a regular array of vortices. No classical object, no object you encounter in everyday life would do that. And this is the ultimate proof that those Bose-Einstein condensates are not just wave-like objects, coherent waves, they also support superfluidity. So maybe to the non-physicists, I should say, I hope you can go home and tell your friends and family that the guy tonight has shown you something really weird. He was talking about gases, and the gas you think is structureless. But I've shown you gases which look like a zebra pattern, and now I've shown you gases which look like Swiss cheese. But both of them are examples about the dramatic changes which happen when you go to the quantum world. Okay, so this is what I wanted to kind of tell you about how low temperatures bring out on a macroscopic scale properties of the quantum world. But let me now make a connection in the last few minutes of my talk to why this field is still very active and why there are still many researchers in Boulder at MIT and in other places studying those quantum gases. So remember, I've taken you really full circle. There were physicists who just wanted to do more precise measurements, and they started to slow down and to cool down atoms. But when they did a good job, they realized there is more to it. At low temperatures, new forms of matter, new forms of quantum matter can form. And I showed you one of our first discoveries. But this now turns into a recipe. We have now discovered quantum refrigerators, and we can now study all sorts of materials. And modern materials govern the world. So we are now using these extreme low temperature setups to learn something about wider classes of materials. So our approach is now, we may make a Bose-Einstein condensate where the atoms stand still, but these are now like Lego pieces, and because they stand still, they can be arranged at will. And this is how we assemble cool atoms into all sorts of materials, and we study them. And what I actually describing to you is nowadays called a quantum simulator. It's a special purpose quantum computer where you assemble something and then nature tells you what is the solution of the equation you have now represented in your laboratory. So now let's go back to the laboratory. How do we assemble atoms in various ways? Well, you know already what we are doing, and we cannot touch the cold matter. We need the ultra high vacuum as a thermos. But we can now send laser beams, we can add magnetic fields, radio waves, microwaves from all different sites and different colors. We have an endless way of changing how the Lego pieces are put together and how they interact. And this is now what many researchers in the world are doing. And let me just give you one example for something special we discovered a few years ago, which is something which has never existed in nature. And we could show that, yes, such a form of matter does exist in nature. And this was the question about a super solid. I don't want to go too much into details, but what it is I've shown you what super is. Superfluidity, I showed you the vortices, I showed you the wave-like behavior, but the question is, can such superfluid properties coexist with a solid behavior? And there was some debate and we found the answer, and yes, it is possible. But maybe also for the lay people, I want to say is that what we have created here is actually at the same time a gas, a liquid, and a solid. And if I talk to high school students, they usually like it because then they realize, gosh, maybe what my physics teacher has told me is not correct. It's not that it's either gas, liquid, or solid. It can be everything at the same time. But this is actually almost trivial because if you tailor the properties of a system, you can give it solid properties in one direction. In the other spatial direction, it's like a gas. And in the third spatial direction, it would be like a liquid. Or you all know liquid crystal displays, which combine the properties of liquidity with crystalline behavior, which is a solid. But anyway, the question about the super solid was that it's a special form of matter and nobody knew whether it would exist or not. And eventually what we did is, let me just show it to you with a cartoon picture. So in a solid, in a crystalline solid, each atom or each ion is localized on one side of the lattice. And this is just the opposite of being superfluid, where all the matter waves have to merge and the atoms have to be delocalized. So the question is, can there be coexistence of those two phases? And at least the cartoon version of the answer is yes. We can have a superfluid wave, but the superfluid wave can have a shape, can have a form. And this is actually the truly defining feature of a solid. A solid has a shape, has a form, whereas a gas and liquid do not have a shape or form. They just fill whatever container you put around them. Okay, I think I'm at the end of my talk. So I try to give you an introduction into the field where we are now using cold atoms to study the properties of matter. And so we are creating with these quantum Lego pieces a model of materials, the model of materials which exist, or we are trying out new materials which have never been observed and we can give a proof of principle for their existence. Now, I mentioned already what we are doing is regarded as a quantum simulator. And so our research is now part of big effort with actually billion-dollar funding programs in Europe, in China, in the US, in the UK, because there are new quantum technologies emerging. There are quantum computers, there is quantum communication, and what I showed you is one part of this whole body of quantum technologies and the techniques we are using to pool atoms to observe the atoms. These are the techniques which are also used in some of the other realizations of those quantum technologies. So with that, let me just come with an outlook that it's actually amazing that in all those years, we're not running out of ideas. This principle to go to very low temperature and study new materials has given us a seemingly endless possibilities. And I talked a lot today about superfluid properties, but currently in my laboratories, we are working much more on magnetic properties, on spin systems, and other forms of phase transitions. So with that, I thank you for the attention, and I'm happy to answer questions.
Thank you so much, Wolfgang, for a wonderful lecture and your dedication to give this lecture, especially under these extreme circumstances. So we have plenty of time for some questions. So you can either maybe raise your hand. Well, that just... you can either type it in the chat and then I'll pick it up and I'll read it for you, or you can just raise your hand and ask the question. So I see David, so maybe, yeah. So Veronica, can you unmute David or maybe I guess I can do it.
Right.
Yeah, yep. You can do it yourself, yeah.
Wolfgang, thank you. That was really marvelous. Your data looks so good. I want to just ask a question. When you were interfering your two BEC balls and seeing the nice, interference fringes between them, there was a type of what looked like a change in the contrast from, across the interference fringes. What was limiting the uniformity of the contrast in those fringes?
By the way, I'm just going to my office, but on my way to the office, I can also go to the laboratory. This is now live, the laboratory which I showed you in the pictures. So you see the machine, this machine, which has produced our first Bose-Einstein condensates, is still operating now in the group of Martin Zwierlein. And it is actually, the students are really amazed. It's a vacuum chamber, which has been under vacuum for more than 20 years. And actually, some of the students are still amazed because when they now work on this machine, because I was actually the person who helped to tighten the bolts on the flanges of the vacuum chamber when it was put together. Well, this were 25 years ago when I was still working in the laboratory. Anyway, so the question was about, sorry for the distraction, but the question was about the interference fringes. What happens is, I mean, those clouds are inhomogeneous, they are Gaussian. It's the same if you take two laser beams. If you interfere two laser beams and they are Gaussian beams and they are not completely perfectly overlapped, you actually see that there is full contrast in the center. But then if you move away from the center, you have a higher contribution from one cloud than from the other cloud, and they cannot completely cancel each other. It's well understood. It's just realization of the geometry of the experiment.
All right. It seemed just a little asymmetric, but any event, it's gorgeous data. It's spectacular talk. Thank you very much.
Other questions?
Yeah, there are questions in the chat.
Okay, so let me look. So Wolfgang, can you see the questions in the chat that maybe you can? So there's one from.
With a microphone sitting in an office. Let me change. Let me now go to the chat. I see there are questions.
Yeah, so the first one is towards the bottom.
see how do you understand the bosons are in the same state?
How to understand the bosons are in the same state as low temperature? Actually, what happens is when you cool down a gas, it becomes slower and slower, and therefore there are fewer and fewer momentum states accessible. So in other words, cooling means that the atoms in the gas now occupying fewer and fewer and fewer states. And if you go to lower and lower temperatures, it seems obvious that you have a situation where the number of atoms, because they are so cold, can energetically only populate a number of states which is smaller than the number of atoms. And at that point, you now have a situation which characterizes the quantum gas, where you have multiple atoms per quantum state. And then all the fun starts, which I have described to you today. The next question is from Jason Eckstein. On the second to last slide, you mentioned solids with an atomic distance of centimeters. Is that because the supercooling enables effective atomic bands that are the macro scale? No, the typical separation between atoms in Bose-Einstein condensates is about a micron or half a micron. So this is the typical distance. And what we can then do is either we have a microscope and can look at it directly, but often it is more convenient to just expand the cloud, as I showed you in some of my slides. And then we can take the object, which is maybe 100 be smaller than the human hair, and blow it up to several millimeters. So then we have an object which is several millimeter, but we still have, we still have many, many atoms in it. And I would say typically the separation between the atoms is never millimeter, it may be several tenths of micrometer. But in principle, so that's what the separation is. But if we take a Bose-Einstein condensate and expand it to millimeter size, which is possible, then you really have a situation that each single atom is delocalized over millimeter. It has a wave function of a macroscopic size. So the next question is, normal fluid has higher density than gas. Why is BEC regarded as a fluid when it's normally low density gas? Well, I think as a physicist, there is a continuous connection between fluids and gases. You also know that the separation between fluids and gases, the phase transition ends at a critical point. So you can actually go from a gas into a fluid without ever crossing a phase transition. So therefore, in many, I don't regard for that purpose the distinction between fluid, liquid, and gas as really fundamental. And we actually sometimes call our system a quantum liquid or superfluid, and then we call it a quantum gas. So I would say, yeah, regard for that purpose that gas and liquid is almost the same.
To be distinguished from the solid that you talked about.
Yeah, or let me maybe actually back up. There is one distinction you can use. A gas is usually very dilute and a liquid is less dilute. But you shouldn't take the densities. Our densities are, you know, crazy dilute. The atomic densities in our gases is 100,000 times smaller than in the atmosphere around it. So this is what people would call lousy vacuum. It's really just, if you have a lousy pump and evacuated chamber, that's the density of gas we are talking about. But you would actually say a gas means particles are almost completely independent, whereas a liquid means that you have actually interactions which are interatomic potentials which are comparable to the temperature. And so in that sense, and important experiments were done in Boulder by actually Eric Cornell to see whether you can make the interactions in the Bose-Einstein condensate so strong that I think then you have really formed a liquid. The gas, a liquid is distinguished from a gas by very strong correlations. And you can now create quantum gases in the weak limit, then it's probably more a gas, but also in a highly correlated limit, and then it becomes more a liquid. And a solid, no, a solid is not necessarily denser. I mean, that's what you learn in high school, that, you know, a solid is denser than a gas, but I mean, density is just a scaling parameter. The defining feature of a solid is, for the physicist, spontaneous symmetry breaking. For the non-physicist, as I said, a solid has a spontaneous shape. So if you have a blob of gas, which is suddenly forming a stripe pattern spontaneously, a density modulation, this fulfills the scientific definition of a solid. Do you need interactions for supersolid? And if you do, can you get by with just nearest neighbor ones? That's a really good question. Let me try to get it right. Yes, we need interactions for the solid. A non-interacting system would never kind of self-organize or form spontaneously symmetry breaking, form some shape. So we need interactions. The supersolid we created had a special interaction, which was spin orbit coupling. So what I actually, what we realized was that a Bose-Einstein condensate with spin orbit coupling can spontaneously have a shape and qualify as a supersolid. In that, this is actually the simplest supersolid. People now do amazing supersolids using dipolar gases where they have strong dipolar interactions. But our supersolid, it fulfills all the criteria for supersolid, but only needed some even weak spin orbit coupling. So I would say, I mean, this is not even next neighbor interaction. We just have a gas where particles interact. And for that special form of supersolidity, some form of mean field interaction was sufficient. So the definition of a supersolid is that you spontaneously form a shape. This shape can be created by different collective effects. The group in Switzerland at ETH used the scattering of light as a collective phenomenon, which helped the atoms to organize as a supersolid. So there were interactions among the atoms, but relatively weak. But then there were interactions which coupled the atoms through photons. In our case, it was spin orbit coupling. And in the most recent spectacular experiment, it is dipolar supersolids coupled by strong dipolar interactions. I think now we are talking to the people at the summer school. Oh, yes.
This is a plug for the summer school. The Swiss group that you mentioned will be lecturing later in the summer school. So
next question is again from Jason Eckstein: with the Bose-Einstein condensate, once you remove the trap, does the whole group have no net linear momentum in any direction, or can it drift around? Well, if you have a Bose-Einstein condensate and we switch off the box, it does what, you know, every object does. It just falls down. So there is linear motion, and it is exactly the linear motion of the normal object. So the Bose-Einstein condensate in 1 second will fall down by 50 centimeter. So this is kind of trivial. And what we do is, when it falls down, we are never measuring the linear motion. We are only interested in the relative motion. And it is the relative motion, how the atoms move with respect to each other, which tells you what the temperature is and what the special properties of a Bose-Einstein condensate is. Tyler Schoenke is asking, can a BEC created with photons or other subatomic particles instead of using atoms? Yes, the answer is what you really need is atoms which have the property of, or particles which have the property of being bosons and not fermions. You may have heard, of course, about the discovery of the Higgs boson, and at least the standard model is saying that the Higgs bosons actually form a Bose-Einstein condensate, which is filling all space. You don't feel them, you don't see it, because it is sort of a vacuum state filled with a Bose-Einstein condensate. But it is the Higgs field is actually the field of the Higgs Bose-Einstein condensate. Can photons form a Bose-Einstein condensate? Well, that depends now. If you take a cavity with photons, black body cavity, a box with photons, and cool the cavity down, you know the Stefan Boltzmann law, which is T to the four at low temperature, the energy density of the photons goes as T to the four. So when you go to absolute zero, you have nothing. You don't have a Bose-Einstein condensate. But this reflects that the photons at low temperature disappear. So if you have a photon gas in thermal equilibrium and you could cool it down without losing the photons at constant photon number, then you can possibly form a Bose-Einstein condensate. The earliest suggestion was that photons would form a Bose-Einstein condensate in a nuclear explosion, because you have a lot of electromagnetic photons and they would thermalize with electrons, and through Compton scattering, they can thermalize without being absorbed. And then in principle, you could form a Bose-Einstein condensate of photons. A little bit closer to home, the group in Bonn of Martin Weitz was able to thermalize photons with a special liquid dye and eventually create thermal photons without absorbing them. And he observed what some people regard as the first Bose-Einstein condensate of photons. Are there limits how cold we can get, and do we expect more surprises if we go even colder? The quick answer is no, there are no limits. And the answer is yes, we are expecting surprises. Now, you may have heard about the third law of thermodynamics, which says you can never reach absolute zero. But that's obvious, because if you cool something down, it gets slower and slower, and each cooling step takes longer and longer. So if we spend a factor of 10 longer, we can maybe cool a factor of 10 lower. But you see that in order to reach absolute zero, it would take, you know, an infinite amount of time, and therefore is not possible. But there is no limit to the ingenuity of students and researchers, how you can hit, how you can maybe go from nano Kelvin to pico Kelvin or even further. Now, do we expect surprises? Yes, we do, but you have to use the right system. If you cool water and it forms ice, you can go to millikelvin and nano Kelvin, nothing will change because ice is already the ground state of water. If we take our Bose-Einstein condensate and would cool it down to pico-Kelvin and lower, nothing would happen because the Bose-Einstein condensate is the ground state of the system. But if we now create, you know, magnetic atoms in a flat band in an optical lattice, then the prediction is that this system will have at pico-Kelvin temperature phase transitions to new forms of matter, some of which have never been explored. As I'm sure will be discussed at this summer school.
Well, it looks like we've come to the end of all the questions and that Wolfgang was so kindly and clearly addressed. So last call for questions, and if there are not, we will bring the lecture to a close. And
Pardon me, Leo, we do actually have a question in YouTube.
Okay.
Is it possible to realize absolute zero in any system if matter is present in surrounding environment in principle?
In principle, yes, because it's a method of refrigeration. You can cool a system, and eventually how cold you get depends on your method of refrigeration. But then, as we painfully experience almost every day in the lab, it also depends on, you know, heat losses, imperfect insulation, or, and this is actually also important for the atoms can actually generate heat because in principle, atoms can form a molecule and release heat. So we are sometimes limited in the lowest temperature because our cold system is internally creating some form of heat. And how low we get in temperature depends how effectively can we remove this heat from the system.
Any other ones, Veronica?
Can I take the liberty of asking a question before we wrap up?
Sure, let me just check with Veronica if there are any other questions in the YouTube.
Sure. We're all good.
Oh, we're all good. Okay, so there's only one. Go ahead, Kate.
So my question is a meta-scientific one. We've had great technical discussion, but we have a lot of young physicists. How can we and they learn how to choose great research questions?
I think follow your curiosity. I think as a young researcher, you have actually a pretty good judgment what is really important. And if you are really excited about something, it's probably quite important. So do a few checks, talk to a few people. But I often feel when we try to recruit graduate students or undergraduate students for our research groups, they vote with their feet. And sometimes they show us what they think is really exciting. And usually they are right. So in other words, I would say, yes, talk to experts, get excited, but in the end, trust your judgment. And when I think back, when I was a postdoc and joined the field, when I was in the 1990s, I just got excited by laser cooling. I just thought, you know, I heard talks and read papers and said, that's one of the coolest things in the world. And then I was just fascinated by absolute zero and I started talking to people, but what happens when we go colder, when we get even colder? And then people told me, well, good luck. I mean, whenever people tried, they failed and there are some limits. Laser cooling cannot go colder. And I started asking, why not? Why not? And eventually myself and other people found a few tricks around it. So trust your judgment. Your judgment is probably better than you think.
There's another question from YouTube from Jim Wilczak from NOAA. Can you can read it yourself if you like. It's the last question in the chat. I can read it to you if you want.
Oh, there is a question in the chat. Yeah, how did you take the pictures of BEC? What kind of light did you use?
Right.
In principle, we can visualize a cold cloud by just using any light, and the light is scattered. And if we take a camera, we can it's a little bit like, how can you look at an object? You can look at an object in principle with any kind of light. But the special properties of Bose-Einstein condensate is that it's very, very dilute. So usually you wouldn't see it. And therefore, we have to use light which is strongly interacting with the atoms. And that means for sodium atoms, we have to use the color of sodium, which is yellow. Or in other words, we always, when we want to visualize atoms, we have to use light, which is close to an atomic resonance.
So you will like this question from Jim Wilczak, actually, a good friend of mine and a scientist from NOAA. He asks, were there any behaviors that you observed predicted by the theory, or were all the behaviors observed predicted by the theory, or did they come up with some surprises, or did you observe some surprises, and what were they, I guess?
Well, there's so many good theorists, including the organizers of the summer school, who have actually made a lot of predictions, and often creative theorists just try to think of everything. The role of the experiment is then often to show, can that really happen in nature? Are those idealized conditions approximately fulfilled in nature? And let me just give you one example. There was, when I pursued Bose-Einstein condensate, there were serious discussions, and I was part of it, when the Bose-Einstein condensate forms and condense, will it just blow up? Because when the condensate forms, it can rapidly form molecules, can do spin flips or other things. And I was in seriously in discussions when we cool down in many situations when the condensate forms, we will see nothing because it blows up. And how could we just catch the short moment when the condensate forms and disappears? So this was really in the realm of possibilities. And the experiment, I think to the surprise of many, has shown that the Bose-Einstein condensate can be very, very stable, and we can do all those experiments which we can do now because the Bose-Einstein condensate is stable. So maybe there was some confusion about the property of Bose-Einstein condensates. Let me give you another example. I can show you papers, and I've actually quoted them, when people say, how can you observe the Bose-Einstein condensate? There were serious theoretical papers by serious people. You know them and they are well known. Some of them said the Bose-Einstein condensate will be completely transparent to laser light. Other papers said the condensate will be pitch black. And other people said the condensate will be reflective and look silvery like a mirror. So here you have three serious predictions. Of course, they all, in one case, it was a misconception about super radiance of a Bose-Einstein condensate, which would make it transparent, which is only, this idealization doesn't take place. Silvery as a mirror would actually require some band gap and some sharp interface. And pitch black, well, it now depends how dense it is. But I'm just saying the experiment has constantly created reality among an endless number of speculations.
I also remember, along the same lines, I also remember in the old days, before vortices were created, there were predictions, theoretical predictions, for how long it takes to nucleate a vortex in a BEC that ranged from microscopic scales to the age of the universe. And so, you know, until those vortices were actually realized in laboratory, you know, there was the range of prediction, theoretical predictions.
There was always a range of predictions. And after it was done experimentally, there was definitely a theorist who could say, I predicted it. But
exactly,
it wasn't completely clear. But I mean, a lot was also, is it possible? I know when we pursued this interference experiment, many people said, this can't happen. This is too idealistic. You can never observe the wave behavior. And now everybody says it's the most trivial thing in the world. So, I mean, the number of surprises where the experiments discovered something which was completely unpredicted, I'm not sure if, I mean, this is really hard. I mean, to do something which none of the theorists has ever thought of. The one example which comes to me in my mind, which completely blew us away, is when we were shining laser light on Bose-Einstein condensate and it created flashes of super radiance. Nobody had predicted that. And we never thought about it. I mean, we wanted to do something completely else in the lab, and suddenly we saw flashes of laser light. Nobody understood it. We were completely surprised by what happens. But then nature told us that it happens, and within a few hours we figured out what was really going on. So that was one of the examples where nobody had ever predicted something. Another case is nobody has really predicted the quantum droplets, which Tilman V discovered. That if you have a dipolar liquid, a dipolar quantum gas, that it will spontaneously form droplets and a ferromagnetic system. So this came as a complete experimental surprise. It's a good mix of theory and experiment. I mean, that makes our field so interesting and so enjoyable to work in.
Okay, well, maybe on that note, and with the hope for many more future surprises, I want to thank everybody who tuned in, particularly the lay people around the Denver and Boulder area. And I also want to thank Wolfgang for going beyond the call of duty to give this lecture. This beautiful, beautiful lecture. And so thank you for tuning in, and watch for us on YouTube, and subscribe to our channel.